entomology, or in fact anything under the umbrella called nature, we are so happy that we all are like-minded and are looking forward to learning about the insect world, which Dr. Chitra Shankar will take us on a journey of the insect world, into the insect world. She calls them masters of camouflage and mimicry, masters of disguise and mimicry. And a little about Dr. Chitra Shankar. Chitra Shankar is principal scientist entomology at the Indian Research, Rice Research Institute under Indian Council of Agricultural Research. She holds a PhD in agricultural entomology from Tamil Nadu Agricultural University, Coimbatore, and specializes in biodiversity of agro ecosystems. Her goal is to enhance the natural control of insect pests in agricultural systems through habitat management and reduced use of insecticide. Dr. Chitra is an avid birder. I'm very happy to tell you that she's a life member of Deccan Birders, our bird society, and she's also a naturalist. Before I give the stage to Chitra, a little about our organization. Deccan Birders is a 40-year-old a bird watching society, Hyderabad based, and we have grown from strength to strength, making our member base into 450 and counting. We organize birding trips within Hyderabad, surrounding areas of Hyderabad, and also outside Hyderabad, outside the state itself. We have been to many states, we have taken our members, and we have gone around birding to almost a lot of bird concentrate parts of India, states of India like Kerala, Goa, Assam, the Northeast. And so that we're still going strong. And this lockdown has, we felt that we must engage with our members even during lockdown. So the idea of webinars stemmed from there. And we have been having fantastic speakers on board. I'm thankful to each and every one of them for coming and talking to our members and increasing our knowledge base. So thank you. This is about our society. And now over to you, Chitra. This is your day and this is your hour. Over to you.
Thank you, Zureika, for the introduction. Good evening, everybody. Thank you one and all for joining me today to go into this amazing world of insects. I especially thank my friends who have joined in this, and my birder friends and my colleagues, and special thanks to Tiffany, who has joined me from Australia at this unholy hour in Australia. And so, to begin with, insects have been here from the time of dinosaurs. They have evolved, they have survived all these years through many tactics. One of them I'm going to be discussing today, that is their mastery of camouflage and mimicry. So today's talk, this is the outline where I will be slightly introducing the origin and evolution of camouflage. And then I'd like to talk about whether there's a difference between camouflage and mimicry, or can we club it together? And then the different types of camouflage and mimicry, and some of the examples, not exhaustive because we cannot, and camouflage in different life stages of an insect. If you look at insects, they have been here for millions of years. So when did they start doing this mimicry? What we can say is that in the early, in the ancient times, there must have been a number of color morphs of these insects, which you see here, or different insects with different colors. And the predation pressure must have removed the obvious colored ones. And the more successfully colored ones, or those that can hide themselves, must have increased in numbers. And that is how we have found that the nature has selected these insects for the successful trait of hiding. And that brings us to the thing that, when did this start? When did they start camouflaging themselves? Recent studies, that is in 2014, they have found an ancient fossil stick insect from Mongolia, and they have named it as Cratophasmomyma myma melanogramma. This is the ancient black-lined stick insect. And these walking stick insects, they found that they have disguised themselves as leaves, and they existed around 126 million years ago, even before the advent of flowering plants. How did they come to a conclusion about this? They have compared this fossil along with leaf fossils found from the same time, and they found the patterns were similar. So we find that the stick insects have mimicked plants even since the age of dinosaurs. So why do they have to mimic or camouflage? The first thing, if you are the prey, it is protection from the predators, and another is they want to scare off the predators from eating them, or they want to direct the attack of the predators to a non-vital part so that they may escape. This is from the prey point of view. From the predator point of view, it is the deceitful entry of the predators into the prey's proximity so that they may be able to catch the insect. So that brings us to camouflage and mimicry. Are they same or are they different? There are different opinions about this. Camouflage basically means a cryptic coloration where the insect is able to blend into the environment so that they will not be found. They do not assume any different shape in this case. Whereas in the case of mimicry, they assume the shape of something else so that they may not, either they can be found, but they will not be eaten, or they may not be found. That is mimicry. But if you ask me, there is a lot of overlapping between camouflage and mimicry, and those that have cryptic coloration also mimic something else. Therefore, I would like to deal today with everything under a single heading of camouflage. So under this, we have five categories, which I'll be talking about today. One is cryptic coloration, which may be either green, brown, mottled, or anything else, and disruptive coloration, or disguise and masquerade, where they assume the shape of something else, and mimicry of various types, which I'll come to again, and using exogenous coverings in which they are hiding. So these are the five categories under which I'll be talking today. The first one, that is the cryptic coloration. If you see, insects are mostly plant feeders. So they have to stay on the plants to feed on the plants. Therefore, the most common color they assume is green. The insects try to blend in with the green background on which they stay and feed. Many of the grasshoppers, katydids, mantids, true bugs, leaf insects and stick insects, which are the masters of disguise when it comes to the coloration and mimicry, and also a number of other insects. So they are all green in color. And even the younger stages mainly of all the insects are green in color. Here the first thing is green herbivores. So do you see the herbivore in the first photo on the left? This is a leaf katydid. This photo has been taken by my young colleague Alfred Daniel. And can you see the katydid? See the antennae here, and then the whole katydid is here. So it totally blends into the shape of the leaf. You can even see the leaf venation here. And this is a hooded grasshopper you're seeing here, which is also blending totally with the green plant. So the herbivores are green in color. Then how do the predators get to them? So they also assume the same color of the plant so that they may be able to get closer to the prey. Not only that, these predators themselves may be predated by other birds and other predators. Therefore, they also have to hide themselves. So can you see the predator on the left-hand side? This is a banded flower mantis. Look at the eyes. The eyes are exactly matching with the seeds of the grass, the panicle on which they are sitting, and also the bands on the legs. They also match with the grass and the color of the grass. And on the right, we have a totally green mantis, which you would see very commonly in the environment. Then coming to the younger stages of insects, there is caterpillars. I have chosen only two of them. One is the cashier butterfly, that is the emigrant, or Catopsylla pomoni here, and the other one is the common barren, Euthalia garuda. So if you see the cashier butterfly, look at even the line, not only the green color, the line that stretches on its abdomen, on its body, which matches with the petiole of the leaf. They perfectly assume the plant coloration in which they are feeding. And the selection of this common baron has something behind it. Of late, that is, I think in the past 1 year, I must have seen a number of videos, viral video of videos of particular caterpillar, which has been circulated in a number of groups, saying that please don't go near the mango tree. There might be a very dangerous insect like this on this. And I have had a number of colleagues and friends writing to me asking if this is a very dangerous insect and what is this. This is nothing but the harmless caterpillar of the common baron butterfly, Euthalia garuda. And the spines which you see helps to diffuse the light and make it more invisible to the predators. If you see closely, they also match with the venation of the mango leaf on which it is sitting. And the central line is matching with the petiole on which it rests. This is a harmless caterpillar of the common baron. Coming to the second most common color in the environment, that is the brown color. And we see a number of insects blending because they either forage in the leaf litter or they rest or take shelter in the dead leaves. So we have the dead leaf mantis here, Deroplatis desiccata, and then the dead leaf grasshopper. And coming to moths, most of the moths, see, moths are generally nocturnal or crepuscular. So they have to stay stationary in one place, so they may get predated upon very easily. Therefore, most of the moths assume very sober colors and take on the color of the environment. And brown colored moths are very common. And coming to butterflies, there are a few crepuscular butterflies like the evening brown belonging to Saturday. And this also assumes the color of brown leaves. Then we have the mottled background. The mottled background like something of the tree bark. In all these categories, the stick insect plays an important role. It assumes the color of all these. And here we have crickets. How many crickets can you see in this bark? Can you see all three? There are three crickets, the wingless crickets on the tree bark here. And then we have a longhorn grasshopper, which has flattened itself against the bark and assumed the shape of the bark. And the cicadas, you would be hearing the sound of these cicadas so well, but then when you're trying to spot it, it is very difficult because cicadas are more or less similar to the bark. The coloration is so similar to the bark that it's very difficult to pick them out. And these are all the herbivores. And they also, the predators take on the bark color. Here I have given a very typical example of the two-tailed spider, the Hercilia species, which assumes the color of the bark. And the top left one is again a cricket. And here, to some extent, there is also auto-mimicry. If you look at it closely, the antennas are here, but then the back region, that is the end of the insect, also assumes two eyes and antennal forms so that the predator will be confused on which side the insect is. So many of the insects assume this kind of auto-mimicry. And then coming to some of the moths also assume, like I told earlier, they assume brown color. Here, this is the stub moth, which is trying to blend in with a broken branch perfectly. And here again, we have another moth, which is blending in with the bark region. And some of the chrysalis, that is pupae, they are also stationary. They cannot move. And that is why they also assume this brown color or green color so that they will not be spotted easily. Coming to caterpillars of moths. Earlier, I showed you two caterpillars which were green in color. They are mostly day feeders. Whereas coming to a number of caterpillars like the lappet moth caterpillars, Lasiocampidae, or the silkworm moths, that is wild silkworm moths, they feed mostly in the early evening, in the evening or the early morning hours. And in the daytime, they stay on the bark. And so they also assume the color of the bark. Can you spot the three caterpillars on the left-hand side? You have three silk moth caterpillars, perfectly, it has merged with the bark region of the tree. Then again, we have some specialized insects which feed on lichen or they stay on a mossy tree, which have also assumed the color and look of lichens. So here on the first image is of a stick insect, which is looking like a lichen. And the second one and the third one, which I would really like to talk about, is Machia hystrix. This is a lichen caterpillar. And this again, there has been a number of viral videos circulating asking what is this insect. So they are not only taking shelter here, but they also feed on this lichen. So they have assumed the look of these lichens so that they will not be found by predators. And the last one is the lappet moth caterpillar, which has also got a mossy covering over it. Then coming to the most interesting part of this cryptic coloration, the industrial melanism. So insects, have evolved in the industrial regions to match with soot from the industrial pollution. That is a typical example, the textbook example, which has been given for Darwinian evolution. And this is the peppered moth, Biston betularia. The Biston betularia was first discovered in 1758. It was described as a white moth with speckles. But towards 1848, during the height of Industrial Revolution, they found in Manchester, in United Kingdom, that there were emerging a number of these moths which were melanized. And this melanistic moth was called the Carbonaria form. And what they found was that these moths rest on lichen-covered trees, which you can see here, and of birch trees, which are covered by lichen. And the soot and sulfur dioxide from the industries have removed or killed off this lichen, and the trees became bare and dark in color. Therefore, the moths were being pressurized by birds, which were predating on it very easily. And slowly, the dark moths started appearing more in number. This was noticed around 1848, and a number of studies were conducted by Bernard Kittlewell from 1848 to 1960. So what he did basically was he has released and recaptured both the moths, and he has decided whether there was a predation pressure on these moths to have made them change the color. So what they found was that, yes, what he found was that the moths, the lighter colored moths, when they were placed on a darker tree, they were predated upon easily. Whereas the darker moth, when it was placed on a lichen tree, it was predated upon easily. But then there was a number of criticisms about it. And there were a lot of theories propounded for this change. This insect has been studied over two centuries. And over these two centuries, there have been a number of theories propounded for this change. One was that the insect under pressure has changed color, and by Lamarckian inheritance, which is the inheritance of change which has been transferred into the offspring. And either it is by toxic ingestion, that is, they have ingested some of the pollutants and this has accumulated in the wings, and that's why they have become darker in color. Or it could be the natural selection or a mutation in particular, which later was proved as the reason for it. or it is an immunity response, because some of the researchers found that the darker forms were more hardy than the lighter forms. So there were a number of theories put forth for this. And a number of controversies as with science, they were surrounding the concept of this industrial melanism. So Michael Majerus, in 2009, he categorized all these criticisms into four categories. One was the issues of ignorance of the ecology and behavior of the moth. This was to a certain extent true, because the moth was discovered in 1758 and the first Carbonaria form was noticed in 1848. So in between, were there dark moths before? This was not known well, because not much study was initiated into this. Only when the Carbonaria form appeared in large numbers, studies were initiated on the ecology and behavior of this moth. Therefore, there is some truth to the ignorance of ecology and behavior. Then there was the issue of poor procedure and experimental protocols of Kettleworth. To a certain extent, this can also be true, because Kettleworth, what he did was he used certain number of trees which had lichen and which did not have lichen, and he kept releasing moths and recapturing them to see whether it is true. So it could also have been a little due to experimental protocols. But then there was a category of pseudo-scientific criticisms, which we always get. You know, people trying to, not those who have not worked on this moth, but they were trying to propound theories about it. And there was a fourth category where there was a journalist who said there was data manipulation and scientific fraud. And again, there was independent inquiry into this, and they found that there was no data manipulation, that there was no scientific fraud involved. And recent studies with better techniques, they have again found, that is in 2012, they have again released recaptured, they have done avian vision models, and all these have supported, they are all supporting that yes, the Carbonaria form has evolved due to pollution. And again, in 1960s, when this was reverted, that is the pollution was reverted with better environmental laws, the peppered form started appearing again. So over 200 years, this moth has been studied, and this is the perfect example for Darwinian evolution. This is not a single case. There are other melanistic forms also during this industrial revolution, which was noticed. One another is the scalloped hazel moth in typical and melanic forms. And then we have the black arches moth, which was also similarly having melanistic forms. Then coming to the second category of coloration, cryptic coloration, that is disruptive coloration. So disruptive coloration is used by many insects. What happens really? This is the concept that was adopted by the army to paint their tanks and using camouflage dresses. What they are doing here basically is that the insects have patches of colors, which breaks down the uniformity of the insect. Therefore, it is not perfectly visible to the predator. Because of the outline which is not visible, so the insect is not visible to the predator. So this is the disruptive coloration, and this is used by a number of moths, beetles and others for camouflage. And then we come to the third category. This is the disguise or masquerade. The first one is grass. That is, many insects assume the shape of the grass on which they forage. Here you see the grass mantid, Chrysocephala biconus. If you see on the left-hand side, the moth tips have got brownish yellow color. Even the legs, if you see here, the legs are all brown in color and yellow in color. And the antenna and the head region is sort of brown, which perfectly matches with the dry tips of leaves on the grass. And when as the grass dries, the form becomes brownish in color. Then coming to green leaf mimics, like I told before, the Leaf insects and stick insects are masters of disguise. So the classic example of green leaf mimic is the leaf insect, which many of us are aware of. And then we also have other insects, such as the scatidid, Pseudophilus. If you see the pronotum or the shoulder, it even has some marks which might look like some damage on the leaves. And then we have the scatidid Tetigonia. And the fourth one is the common Nawab caterpillar. Look at this caterpillar. This feeds on acacia, and the larval color has assumed the pinnate leaves, the compound leaf coloration of the host on which it rests. That is the first level of mimicry. The second level of warding off predators is the head, in which there are a number of horns, which helps to scare away the predators. Then we come to the dead leaf mimics. And this is one of my favorite butterflies, that is the orange oak leaf butterfly, Calyma inacus. And if you see here, in a closed wing state, you can even see the petiole of the butterfly, a petiole of a leaf in this butterfly, and you can see the line which is like the leaf vein. But when it opens, it has bright colors. Then you can ask me, why does it have a color like this, cryptic color like this, and then bright coloration like this? When it opens and closes, the predator gets confused by the flash of color, and then it turns brown. And also the coloration is required for attracting its own mates. Therefore, it has both of these colorations. And moths, if you come to moths, the moths are also, a number of moths have these leaf-like structures. If you look at this Euterote moth, that is a hairy caterpillar moth, Ganesa pandia, you can see the leaf vein running through its body, and it has a perfect coloration of the leaves on it, on which it rests. And here you have the brown caterpillar, Leptodorus dianensis. We have both green and brown forms based on wherever they are foraging. Then we come to the next category, that is a twig or a branch. If you see here, the first one is a silk moth caterpillar. And this has assumed a defense position. When it senses that a predator is close, then it tightens its pronotum and then lifts its upper body to look like a twig. And the second image here is that of a geometrid or an inchworm or a looper caterpillar, which is looking exactly like a lichen-covered stick. This is from China. And the third one, which I would come again to, is this the Leuca stub moth, Discophlebia leucasi. This is from Australia. And if you see, it is perfectly mimicking the broken branch or cut branch. The light coloration in the head matches with the cut region of the twig. And also the tip of the wings, that is the edges of the wings, also assume this coloration, giving it a twig-like appearance. And then we have other semilupers of silk moths, and then we have the stick insect, which assume the shape of twigs or branches. And then we come to the colorful flower mimics. Here we have two classic examples. One is the flower mantid and the other is the crab spider. The flower mantids stay within the flower and wait for flower visitors like butterflies and flies to predate upon. And they assume such colors, they look exactly like a part of the flower. And look at the mantid here. It even folds, and then it folds its praying legs, front legs in such a position that it mimics the flower on which it sits. And here you can see the thomisus or the crab spider, which has caught hold of a syrphid fly which had visited the flower. And this is again thomisus, which has assumed the color of the flower on which it is resting. While I was looking through pictures, I came across a video of this moth, which this caterpillar, which is unidentified, which is mimicking a feather. The movement is looking like exactly a feather which is being blown by wind. So some of the moth caterpillars also assume the shape of feathers in order to fool the birds. And a very interesting thing is this bird drop. Some of the insects assume the shape of bird droppings. These two examples, that is the bird dropping spider and the lantana beetle, are from Australia. The bird dropping spider, Selenia excavata, looks exactly like a bird dropping when it has not got its eggs extended. But when it's extending its legs, it becomes totally different. And the lantana beetle, it is a leaf miner. And when it is on the leaf, it looks like a bird poop. Coming to the classic example, the papilionid larvae, the early instars assume the shape of bird droppings, whereas the later instars, they have different types of defense. First, they are green in color and blend with the plants. And second, they have osmeterium, which releases a chemical substance that wards off the predators. And we have some of the moths that also mimic the bird droppings. Then coming to the other important part of this, that is the mimicry. And mimicry is assuming the form of some model so that they will not be eaten. So there are a number of types of mimicry. And the first one is Batesian mimicry, which is named after Henry Walter Bates, an English naturalist who has done a lot of work in the Amazon. The mimicry by this mimicry is the model is an unpalatable species. Like here, it is the Danas crassicus or the plain tiger, which feeds in its larval form on a poisonous plant or a noxious plant and collects those poisons or sequesters those poisons in its body. And this is transferred to the adult state. And most like birds, when they feed on this, they are emetic and they have cardinolides, which also cause heart, they are called heart glycosides, which causes a lot of issues to the birds feeding on it. So the bird learns to avoid this color. And here you find the mimic, that is a palatable species, Hypolimnus mysticippus or danaid egg fly, which mimics this Danas crassicus in order to avoid predation because it's looking so similar. If you see how to differentiate, you can see two lines running across this, and that's how you differentiate between this and its model. But the predator avoids, once it has learned, it avoids butterflies of similar color. Therefore, this mimic, and mostly the mimic is the female. Not mostly, the mimic is always the female. The male, on the other hand, is black in color. Why does the female mimic? Because the female is heavy with eggs and it needs to, and it's easily predated upon. So it mimics a unpalatable species. It not only mimics this, but it also mimics the striped tiger species. Another example is the common mormon, which is the lime butterfly or Papiliopolitis. The male is black in color, whereas the female assumes many morphs. That is, there are three forms, Stichius, which mimics the inedible common rose, and then the Romulus form, which mimics the inedible crimson rose. Here you find the one which is mimicking that is the Stichius, that is, it is mimicking the inedible common rose species. So, if you think about this, there is some kind of cost to this. If the model is not more abundant, then the mimic will not gain by it. So always the model should be a highly abundant species. For example, if the Hypolimnus mimic is more in number, then the number of palatable species picked by birds would be more. Therefore, the birds would not avoid that color. Therefore, the model should be the more abundant species for the mimic. And that is why the female also spreads it out and has many moths so that they will, at least a few of them is able to survive. Not only in butterflies, there are also other insects which use this Batesian mimicry. So here we have the model as stinging wasps and a number of hoverflies which are harmless and palatable, which mimic these wasps, stinging wasps. And also we have some of the beetles, such as this wasp beetle and the orange and black locust borers, which also mimic the wasp. Is it only palatability which is being mimicked? No. Recently, in 2012, there was a study in the Namib Desert of Africa on scarabs. So what they found was that the scarabaeus group are all agile flyers. And whereas there were some of the terrestrial scarabs, like this Pachysoma denticolae, which were neither agile nor they could fly. But what they did was, this Pachysoma denticolae has been assuming the coloration of scarabaeus because predators generally avoid an agile insect because there is some amount of energy wastage in that. And therefore, when a non-agile, sluggish or one wingless form, which mimics an agile form, it is gaining from that. So this is called as Batesian speed mimicry. Coming to the second group, that is the Müllerian mimicry. This is named after the German naturalist Fritz Müller. And in this, two or more species which have similar warning or aposematic signals. And all of those species which form similar colorations are unpalatable, and they form a group so that the predators know that, okay, this color combination is not good for me. So these mimetic butterfly communities are called the butterfly rings. There are three important butterfly rings which are observed. The most important is the tiger Danas mimicry ring. This feeds on Asclepiadaceae plants. So they have these cardinolites, which are sequestered in the larval stage, and they are transferred to the adult forms. So these adult forms are not palatable for birds. And similar unpalatable butterflies are all similar in coloration. That is, orange and black is assumed, like in the case of these two butterflies here, which you see, this plain tiger, striped tiger, Argyris, or the male and the female fritillaries here. Then the second group is the Idea or tree nymphs. These tree nymphs feed on Aposinaceae plants. Aposinaceae plants are also having some amount of toxins. Therefore, these again have some idiomines in them, which are not palatable to the birds or other predators. And a number of palatable species also follow these tree nymphs. And the third group is the red-bodied swallowtails. All the red-bodied swallowtails, which feed on Aristolochia and having aristolochic acids, are all black and red in color and are avoided by the birds. So there is also another one, that is the Thirumala group, which is the blue tiger group, which you must be aware of. This also forms, two, three of them form similar coloration of black and blue. And coming to another group of another mimicry, that is the Vasmanian. So this mimicry was named after Eric Wasmann, an Austrian entomologist. And this is mainly concerned with mimicry concerned with social insects, where the mimic resembles one of the social insects and they either coexist with them or they utilize that for being a parasite on them or aggressively use it. The number of cues used here, visual, chemical and tactile, which I will be telling one by one. In this picture, if you see, you would think that all of them are Camponotus ants. But no, one of them is a plant bug mimic, which is a mimic of the Camponotus planitus. And it is just taking protection from being along with it. So these are called inquilines. So inquilines are those which coexist with the social insect and do not cause harm to them and only stay there and assume that form because they have some protection. I would like to explain this Vasmanian mimicry with myrmecomorphy. Myrmecomorphy means looking like ants, that is ant mimicry. Ants, you know, are found, they're ubiquitous in all regions of the world. And they are not very palatable. Therefore, most of the insects in their young forms assume the shape of ants, both including predator and the prey. They assume ant forms in order to protect themselves. Here we find, these are called, which coexist, they are called as inquilines. And those that take something from the social insect is called a parasite. And here we find the beetles, a bush cricket nymph, and then we have the mirid ant bug, a sepsid fly, and also a reduvid nymph, all assuming the shape of ants in their early stages. I'd like to talk about a very curious case of the Australian walking insect, walking stick, that is Extatosoma tyreatum. In this case, what happens is the female of the walking stick flicks her, they live in the forest, and it flicks her eggs up to several feet, which lands on the forest floor. These eggs need to be at a 25 degree centigrade in order to hatch. These eggs have a knob-like structure, which is called a scapulum, which has some fats and some organic compounds, which are very attractive to the ants, especially to one species, Leptomyrmex. And this Leptomyrmex ant, what it does is, it carries these eggs to their nest once they find them. And there, the edible outer portion or the capitulum is fed upon, and then the intact eggs are dumped into the waste piles. But feeding on this outer portion does not reduce the viability of these eggs. These eggs remain in these waste piles and slowly hatch there. And these newly hatched nymphs are mimics of the ant genus, and they look like the ants. They are very fast moving, but they do not stay in the ant hill after they hatch out, and slowly they move out and they go up and stay in the tree. So in the early part up to hatching and the first instar, they take the protection of the ant hill and the temperature control within the ant hill for hatching. And the second case is that of lichenid butterflies. Here, chemical mimicry is used. The lichenid butterfly, butterfly larvae, many of them like Aloides and Lepidochrysops, they mimic ant species. They let out some chemicals like the brood pheromone of the ants or alarm call of ants. And they are attended upon by ants because of this smell. But the cherry of the cake is taken by the large blue butterfly, Fengaris arion, which has a very typical relationship with the ant Myrmica subulata. What happens here? This is the present in the United Kingdom and many parts of Europe. And in 1979, the large blue butterfly became extinct in the United Kingdom, after which a number of ecological studies were started here to know why this species has disappeared. They found that there was a lot of habitat destruction. It was reintroduced from other parts of Europe into UK, but it did not establish. So more studies were conducted on what is required for this blue butterfly. And they found, what they found was very, very interesting. This blue butterfly lays eggs on thymus plant, and the larva on hatching feeds upon the thymus plant till the fourth instar. In the first image here, you find the larvae which has reached fourth instar, but it does not even have 2% of the body weight it's supposed to assume. What it does is, once it reaches the fourth instar, it falls to the ground and stays still, waiting for an ant to come to. The ants belonging to Myrmica species attend to it because it secretes a honey-like substance. And these ants, once they find a larvae, may feed upon this secretion even up to 1 hour. After this, the larvae, it becomes turgid, and then it twists, it contorts its body in such a way that it looks like a grub, and it also emits some chemical cues which makes the ant thinks that it is a brood. So the ant picks up this larvae and carries it to its nest and places it among its own grub. Here, if you see, this is the grub of the this is the larvae of the large blue butterfly, and these are the ant grubs, and then it becomes a parasite. From the fourth instar onwards till pupation, this lichenid predates upon the ant grubs. It starts feeding. Here you can see it feeding on an ant grub, and it pupates within the ant hill. Not only that, it overwinters as a pupa here for several months inside the ant hill, and then emerges. This is the peculiar system which has evolved in the large blue butterfly, Pengaris, and the ant Myrmica subulata. Then we come to aggressive mimicry or Pecamion mimicry. This also is seen in an anthill. And if you see here, this is the red ant, Ecophyllus merna, which you can see a number of nests which are built on trees. A number of us would have observed and also bitten by it. And this one below it is a spider that is mimicking this ant, Mimarachne platyleoides. And what it does is, this spider not only gets into the colony and mimics the ant, it starts predating upon the ants being there. So this is an aggressive mimicry where the predator assumes the form of the prey so that it may predate upon it. This is called Pecamion mimicry or aggressive mimicry. Similarly, a number of ants, a number of spiders also assume the form of Camponotus or black ants. This is Aphantochilus rogersi, which is found in South America. And this is an ant mimic of Camponotus ant, which is found in India. And I have missed on this. There is also the Vasmanian tactile mimicry. What is tactile mimicry? Vasmanian is related to social insects. So mites belonging to the family Uroporidae, that is Planodiscus, are phoretic mites which are carried by insects, and they stay there and feed on them. What happens is, so you must have seen the ants always clean themselves. So how do these mites escape from that kind of grooming? So these mites have such a structure that the cuticle is culturing, and the CT of the mite body resembles the culturing of the ant's leg, which it attaches itself to. So this, what it happens is, when the ant is grooming its leg, it has a tactile sensation that it's grooming its own leg and there are no mites. So that is how these mites get transported to other places. This is called tactile mimicry. And then there is another category of mimicry called the Gilbertian mimicry. It was coined by Pasteur as a phrase for a very rare form of mimicry system. It is named after the American ecologist Lawrence E. Gilbert. What happens here, especially there is one typical example that is of the plant Passiflora. So what happens here is, these leaves have toxins that generally deter herbivorous animals, but the Heliconius butterfly larvae have evolved enzymes that can break down these toxins, and they specialize on this Passiflora genus. So Passiflora, under pressure, it evolved egg dummies from the stipules of the leaf. That is a part of the leaf which turns like, if you see this top left-hand picture, you will see these yellow spots. They are leaf stipules which look like the eggs of the Heliconium butterfly. What happens in Heliconius butterfly is, they are highly cannibalistic, and therefore the butterfly will not lay eggs when it is overcrowded. So these egg dummies prevent the Heliconius butterfly laying more on the leaves. In addition, these tripules also produce honey. They are nectaries and also attract predators of these caterpillars such as ants and moths, which act as a further defense. So this is a very typical mimicry which is found in nature called the Gilbertian mimicry. Then coming to the last type, that is the automimicry or Broverian mimicry. This is mostly intraspecific. One condition here, which I talked which I should have told about earlier. It is a type of Batesian mimicry where the palatable members of the same species are defended by the resemblance to members of which are unpalatable. Also, some of the insects, they have eye spots or some things that look like a different animal or false head which misdirect the predators. This all comes under automimicry. In the case of the first intraspecific mimicry, there is an example from the common tiger. The common tiger, like I told before, it feeds in its larval stage on the Calotropis plant, which has toxins. And these toxins are transferred to the adults. But the adults don't keep this throughout their life cycle and it is lost after some time. But because the older adults resemble the younger adults, which are unpalatable, they escape. So this also comes under the automimicry or Broverian mimicry. And here I have given some examples of eye spots where the predator thinks that the insect is here and tries to attack it. But the insect is saved because only with some amount of damage to the wings, they are able to fly away. In leaf hoppers, tree hoppers, you could see the backside having head-like structures so that these are attacked, whereas the front are saved. Some of the insects also assume forms as vertebrates or other invertebrates. Here is the chrysalis of the owl butterfly, Dynastodarius, which looks exactly like a snake. And this is the caterpillar of a sphingid moth, which has these spots. And when a predator comes close or when it is threatened, it bends over and looks like a snake. It shows its spots to resemble a snake, scaring away predator. Here you see a cassia caterpillar, which is assuming the form of a snake, green snake. We also have lobster caterpillar Storopus species. And then this, most of us must have noticed this caterpillar on the Nerium or Oleander plants. And when you go close to it or touch it, it pulls its prothorax or pulls its front part into itself and displays its eyes like it is something else. And here we have the Atlas moth, whose wing tips resemble that of a cobra snake. So they also try to mimic other venomous creatures in order to ward off the predators. Coming to the last category, that is the exogenous coverings. That is, many insects, they form bags or covers and hide and these covers are also taken from the environment in which they live in, like these bagworms of the cycadid family. The caterpillar stays inside and they build these houses of the sticks of the host plant and they stay inside safely. They are inaccessible for the predators. Another thing which we noticed in lacewing larvae, these are predators in the larval form. And they predate upon the aphids. And they keep throwing the carcass or all the debris they find around in the leaves onto their back. And this actually gives them a hiding place. And also it helps them to avoid predation. We also have the case bearer of the tinnate moths. There are a number of cases, even cloth moths form these kind of cases, and you would have seen it in the houses where these cloth moths have been found. So how ancient is this? Actually, there's a very interesting thing about a recent discovery of an ancient plant-insect interaction, which I was talking about, an exogenous material which was used even in the time of dinosaurs. What they have found is a fossil dating to early Cretaceous amber from Spain. And this is of a green lacewing. And this green lacewing has formed a trash packet, which is totally composed of trichomes of a fern on which it inhabits. Each of the trichomes are taken from the fern, and they have been attached to the green lacewing larvae. And this is a reconstructed version of the green lacewing. This was recently published in PNAS. And then coming to mimicry of different life species. So, not only, you know that insects go through many stages. Either it would be egg, larva, pupa, adult, or it will be nymphs and adults. And in all the life stages, they assume different types of mimicry. For example, in the egg stage, if I take the Spalgius epius here, this is a predatory lichenid on mealybugs. So the eggs are looking just like they are white in color, and they blend with the mealybugs on which it is found. And the larva assume a similar shape to that of the mealybugs on which they predate upon. And the pupa, it is a very, very unique one. It is called the ape fly because the shape of the pupa resembles that of a monkey. And it is supposedly it wards off the predators. So in each stage, you can see that mimicry is assumed in an insect. So that brings us to the end of this presentation. Thank you so much for listening. A special thanks to Deccan Birders for the opportunity. I also thank my friend Alfred for his images, and my friend Chira for subjects. And thanks to my family.
Fantastic presentation. Thank you for such an exhaustive. It was really an exhaustive. And I love your pictures. I think they were amazing. We got to see some insects that we have never seen before. And I love the, especially the one that looked like the feather, exactly like the feather. Thank you so much, Chitra. Now, can we open the floor for question and answer?
Yes, ma'am. I would like to know if there is any book for beginners on entomology. Any recommendations for Chitra, ma'am?
I did not get your question.
No, I want to know if there is any reference books.
Oh, there are insect books. See, insect.
Can you suggest some which is really good?
Insect world is very vast. So if you want to start on butterflies, you have a number of butterfly guides. You have a moth book by Subbalakshmi. Then you have books for social insects. You have separate books for a lot of insects. So, but sadly lacking in India is official guides. There is one insect guide from Rishi Valley, I think, by Geeta. So you can start with guides. You're looking for guides or basic books. So there are two types of books. So if you want to identify insects, then guidebooks should be the way you should go.
Guidebooks, especially guidebooks.
So you can start from insects, a number of Lefroy and a lot of Indian insect books that are there, which are simple. Lefroy is a good book. And if you want colored pictures, then I think Geeta Iyer has published one from Rishi Valley.
Okay,
Chitra, this question is from JVD Murthy. has mimicry evolved as a defense mechanism against only one species of predator, or does it go across other species as well?
Across. It is predators in general.
Any management practices for stem borer in Casuarina, where larva is damaging stage and larva will be inside stem by making tunnel? This is from Ashok Kulkarni.
This is applied entomology, which I really would not like to discuss in this presentation. You can always write to me on my mail ID if you would not discuss applied entomology. I would be happy.
Okay, this is from Galaxy. The ant community, don't they identify the external intruder? Do they have mimics in larger creatures?
Come again, Surekha.
Okay, no problem. I can repeat that. The ant community, don't they identify the external intruder? Do we have mimics in larger creatures, larger than ants, perhaps?
Yeah, actually, did you see the caterpillar I showed of the oak of the large blue? You see the size of that and size of the ants. They emit some kind of substance. The chemicals, which, you know, mask that they are different intruders, and that's why the ant is accepting them. Did you understand?
Surekha?
Chitra, I must tell you, you got tremendous number of compliments. Tremendous number of compliments. And one gentleman called it, I think Dr. Yadav, he called it transcendent presentation. So I'm happy to pass on that. So we go to the next question. This is from JVD Murthy again. Can mimicry be used as a tool in the study of evolution of animal communication? And this is because that starts from conspicuously signals which postulate that a receiver is interested in them. This question is from a professor, so I'll repeat that. Can mimicry be used as a tool in the study of evolution of animal communication? And then this is because it starts from conspicuous signals which postulate that the receiver is interested in them, ?
See, insect communication is a very, very big, what do you call it? It is a huge study. There are a lot of communication, chemical communication things which are used in the insect world. They use it for attracting a mate. They use it for saying the alarm. They use it for a number of things. So insect chemical communication is the ultimate thing, actually. And it is easier to study in insects because they have a short life cycle. And so you are able to rear them and observe them in the lab. So this is a very good model for such kind of studies.
Surekha, may I interpose one more question, please? Murthy here.
Of course. Yes, sir.
That caterpillar that you showed, the one that mimics a feather, I think it's from Ecuador, because I received a WhatsApp video from one of my...
Yes, sir. Today I was seeing, I have actually used a lot of WhatsApp videos because a lot of people ask me, what is this? So I have tried to use captures from WhatsApp videos so that people will know what it is. Yes, it is from Ecuador. I have used...
Has it been identified? Has it been identified? And how?
No, it has not been. Even I looked for it. It must be a hairy caterpillar of Arabidae, I think. But I don't have an idea of what the species is.
Does it fit into any fixed pattern that has been researched so far in terms of mimicking?
No, actually, mimic mimicking, there are a number of, see, we know that insects mimic a lot of things, and there are studies all over the world for different forms. So this is well documented. It must be documented somewhere.
Then how would you classify the certain moths which have this hairy things on their legs, or they make some kind of counter signals to disrupt the bats' eco-locating system? Would that also come in a kind of way as a defense mechanism, though not directly?
Yeah, if you think of defense mechanism, yes. But if you think of mimicry and camouflage, no. Actually, what happens is, that is again a different thing. How bat eco-locates prey, and how the prey tries to ward off the predator. So there are different defense mechanisms, and I have talked about only one. I have just touched the tip of an iceberg. The insect world is amazing. It has got so many different facets, and each one is a big.
Yeah, I realize that I'm halfway down drowning right now. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Question from Smita Chatterjee. I have a pic of Dilophila neri.
Huh,
I know the blue colored dots are real eyes or fake. Someone told that it is the back. Is it its backside?
That is the picture I put in the invertebrate thing. It is not real eyes. They are eye spots. Actually, what the larvae does is, even you can test that because it is in your garden. When you go close and touch it, the front body is brought inside and the eyes, which are a little behind, are brought forward so that it looks like something big is looking at you. It is actually not the real eyes. That's not even the real head. It is the body.
Camouflage versus mimicry. This is from Fussy. How do they differ? Can I say mimicry is throughout the life and camouflage is just for a short time period?
No. See, they are actually overlapping. That's why I dealt with on a common topic. But camouflage basically means they are blending into the environment, whereas mimicry is where they assume the shape, form, or chemical cues of some other model. So it could be tactile or something, but there is a model, there is a mimic. But whereas in camouflage, see, for example, just the color. They don't have to assume any shape. You just have to have a brown color and sit on a dry leaf, then that is camouflage. That is some of the people classify it like that. But whereas camouflage in some ways can be taken as the broad thing under which mimicry also falls.
Shweta, any example of insects which predates on sandal plant?
So many
and are there any mimicking procedures?
What is the meaning of sandal plant?
Like this apple and pass.
There is some conversation going on. Shweta, what is sandal plant? Shweta, if you are there.
No, what is it that you want to know? That it imitates a sandal plant?
Any example of insects which predates on sandal plant?
See, when you
are there mimicking
feeds on a plant, it is not called as predation. It is herbivory. So there are a number of insects on each plant and tree. They have their own niche, and a number of insects feed on that. There are herbivores, there are predators on these herbivores.
Yeah, okay. So we have a few more questions here in the chat, Chitra. I can't identify the name. Okay, the question is, Madam, does vertebrate chameleon changing colors or mimicry is equivalent or older than insect mimicry?
Chameleon and reptile mimicry would have started, at least in chameleons came later because dinosaurs were the first. Okay, so it okay. Must have come as they appeared in the world, they must have also evolved. But insects are very old.
Very well. Okay, ma'am. There's one more question from Tiff. Are there examples of UV reflectance being used in predator deterrence? Birds and insects see in the UV part of the spectrum.
So everything that the birds view will be in the UV spectrum. So whatever the camouflage the insects are using will be addressing that.
Okay. So I think you already answered this question. What is the difference between camouflage and mimicry? I think you already answered this. That was from Ashonan. One second. Okay, there's a question from Kalpana. Recently, I observed a wasp carrying away eggs from the egg case of a signature spider. Would you know which family of wasp I should be looking at to understand this better?
Spider wasp. Spider wasp generally use spiders as prey. I don't know why it carried the egg case, but generally it carries the spiders and then it digs a hole and puts it inside for its own young. You know, they inject a nerve toxin so that they stay there. They are alive, but they can't move. And then their young feed on it. So
okay.
You should be looking for spiders.
Okay. I think I can see a lot of questions from Sonam. I think, can you just repeat the same? What is the difference between camouflage and mimicry?
So camouflage is actually blending into the environment, like swabber birders do. They wear green or brown and try to blend into the environment. Whereas we have ghillie suits and camouflage suits so that you get close to get a good photograph. That is, that's a different form. And then you have the mimicry where you try to assume the shape of something else.
Okay. I think that should answer Shonam and everyone. Guys, whoever have raised hand, I'll take them at the last because I could see a lot of chats here. So sorry for that. Does parasitoid differentiate these mimics? I'm not wrong. I'm just reading it. PARASITOID.
No, where is it?
Does parasitoid differentiate these mimics? That's the question.
No, I think you can see all the questions in the chat.
It's parasitoid.
I'm just typing it again.
Does parasitoid differentiate these mimics? The parasitoids actually, which stage are you talking about? See, actually, I'm talking about adults. So in adults, it's not parasitoids. Actually, they come to the larval stage. In the larval stage, have got cryptic coloration. So the Batesian, I think your Batesian you're asking about, the Batesian mimicry, it does not have the parasitoid level. It has the predator level.
Okay, one question from Parth.
Spiders are not insects, they belong to class Arachnida. Yeah, somebody asked this question. Then fuzzy. Clarity, camouflage happens for a short period. No, it is not like that. It does not happen for a short. Chameleon, actually, because chameleon is the standard example for camouflage, that's why I think everybody is asking this. That they come into an environment and then they change. No, in insects, that does not happen like that. It has to have some time. Sometimes it changes color based on what it's feeding on. For example, the host, it changes color based on what it's feeding on or its environment, but it takes some time. It's not temporary.
Okay, we have more questions on the top. Okay, a question from Parth. We humans do not give importance to insects. Since we humans are unaware about their role in balancing the ecosystem. Can you please explain everyone how and what role they have?
Hopefully I might be giving a talk on this of how they are ecosystem engineers, but without insects, a lot of our ecological services will be cut. First, pollination. You take pollination. We would not have fruits. So if you say we would not have fruits, you would understand that better. And then you will not have a number of other ecological services because of insects. Turning of the soil, degradation of some material, and turnover of nutrients. So many things are done by insects. There are harmful insects, there are useful insects. Harmful and useful, actually classification based on human needs.
Okay. So Umesh has a question about crab spider. He can, Umesh, you can directly ask Chitraji.
Yeah, Umesh. Thank you, Umesh, for joining.
Hey, Chitra, how are you doing? Long time. Okay, a quick question on the crab spider, Chitra. You showed us two pictures. One was on that yellow flower and then there was on the pink flower, right?
Yeah.
What I wanted to know is, you know, when it moves, is it the same individual? Can it move from one flower to the other?
No. Actually, they stay in a place. Actually, from nymphal stage, they stay in a place and sort of assume the color of the environment they are in. In crab spiders, the colors change, variably change in the right. same species. But it is over their lifetime. Over the lifetime.
How long does it take? Or how long is the lifetime for them?
A few days.
Okay. So for them to develop that color also, it's a few days.
So for developmental periods, they will develop from the instars actually. Even spiders go through instars. Just right. insects. So six instars. So they would be same place for something. Maybe it will take 2 months for it to develop into a full adult. And then right. in the adult stage, they may stay. So over these 4 months, they may assume the shape of the environment. So even your flower may not be there.
Okay. Right. Okay. Thank you, Umesh.
We have been, I think there is Debjyoti who is waiting since long. So Debjyoti Chakravarti, can you please ask the question directly? Hello, ma'am. Hello, Jyotiji, are you there?
Jyoti, you can ask your question directly.
Okay, we'll go for the next question from Sangeeta Jain. Sangeeta Jain, you can ask the question directly.
Thank you for the very nice. So mimicry is something which is very.
Yeah, I note my mail ID. I can send you some information on it. There are a few ebooks which I can share with you.
Okay. So you'll share your mail ID with me. I can send a test mail to you.
I think it was there on my first slide.
I'm sorry, I missed it.
Should I share? I'm going to type here to all.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, that will be good.
You got it?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Srikant, you can ask ma'am directly.
Hi, Chitra ma'am, how are you?
I'm good, Srikant. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. It was a lovely presentation, and I think kind of what sometimes you teach us on our birding trips as well. We have revisited. So I was very happy listening to this. But I have one question. I mean, I think the same question which I ask you sometimes on the field as well. What are the different insects, larvae? I mean, there would be some insects, larvae or moths or butterflies, which the birds don't feed on. So if they don't, why do they don't?
That's what I talked about in the Batesian mimicry.
Exactly.
And the Müllerian mimicry. What happens is some of these more butterflies, not butterflies exactly, the larval stages. These plants have toxic substances, but the larvae are enzymes which break this down, and these substances are stored in the larval body, and then they are transferred into the adult form. And these adults, for example, cardinolites, nymphs, you know, those tree nymphs group, and then the red bodied swallowtails, and then the tigers, all of them have these substances in the body. Emetic properties. So when a bird, not that they'll never feed on them, they will have first choice. They might feed on them first, and they will learn to avoid that color. That's how they learn unpalatable.
Because when you were speaking about Mullen theory,
yeah,
that's when once I think we have actually discussed this about red-bodied swallowtail actually feeded by being eaten by a bird, which you said is an uncommon thing.
Yeah.
So I think that is why again my thought. I mean, are there any other species of insects?
See, there are mimics which mimic these, okay,
mm-hmm,
which are palatable, which I talked about. You know, this lime butterfly, which is very common, even in your curry patta, yes, you would be seeing that. So this butterfly has got many forms, actually the female, and these forms take on the red body ones. They look like the red-bodied papilionids, but they are palatable. So if a bird has fed on it and have not got it out, maybe possibly it is one of these.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thanks, man. That's lovely. Lovely to hear you again.
Yeah. Next is Pratibhan. You can ask ma'am directly. Prasiban? I think we lost Prasiban. Okay, next is, one second. Shivabal MK.
Shivabal.
Chitra, that was lovely presentation. You did phenomenal. And it was very, very happy to listen to the whole episode. Lovely presentation. You took a lot of efforts in collecting all those stuff. And the presentation was too good, and I am fortunate to have shared that thing through Facebook and shared that the group, and I hope my class of 83 also would have been in sitting with us. Thanks for that, and good. Wish you all the very best. Thank you,
Jirvan.
Chitraji, we have one question which involves some scientific terms. I don't want to do the mistake again. I'm typing it in the chat. I'm typing it in the chat itself. This question is from Rashmi, Dr. Rashmi. Yeah, the first question that you...
Okay. So, Euthalia garuda caterpillar's hairs are not harmful, but mango. No, it does not mimic. Actually, Euthalia looks so different from Latoya. Latoya has got glandular hairs, and it looks very different, and it is very obvious. Actually, you will be able to spot a Latoya lepida caterpillar very easily because they are in groups. They are in groups. They have glandular hairs, and their defense is their glandular hairs. Whereas Euthalia caterpillars is hidden. They don't want to be found. They will stay on a leaf looking like a leaf. I hope I have answered that.
Okay. I think one more question from Fahir. Phenotypic plasticity, which happens in locust while they changes to gregarious phase, can we say it is a camouflage within species?
No, it is not.
I think Prasad sir answered that. Yeah,
I think YG Prasad sir would be a better
person. I just saw it. He answered it. Yeah. Okay, one more question from Fahiz. Thank you, Chitraji. Just for clarity, camouflage happens for a short period when they are mimicking their surrounding. Once they are out of that, they change to normal. But in case of mimicry, insects always mimic a model. There is no change or something like that? Am I right?
So this is the same question which was asked earlier. So okay. Mimicry, what they were trying to say is that cryptic coloration or camouflage is temporary, whereas mimicry is permanent. No, you cannot say that in insects, actually. In insects, see, pigmentation, even if the color changes, it takes some time for it over its life cycle to change. It is not like a chameleon where it just walks out of the insects. Like you put one spider on top of a yellow flower and it changes from white to yellow. No, it cannot happen like that. It needs some time to change the pigmentation. Over some time only it can assume this. And it is not temporary. In most of these are not temporary. For example, a common tiger will always be a common tiger. It will be brown. A brown moth is going to be brown all its life. It's going to be a brown moth all its life.
Okay.
And that is camouflage.
Okay, one more interesting question. There's no name. Why only few examples of mimics compared to vast insect species? Is it survival pressure?
What was that?
Why only few examples of mimics compared to vast number of insect species? Is it because of survival pressure?
No, I am not able to exhaustively give. I told that in the presentation, I am giving only examples. I cannot talk of all the examples present in each category. If you take green insects, you will have thousands and thousands. You will take brown insects, you will have thousands. So I have just given classic examples. I have tried to limit myself within that 1 hour.
So almost all insects have...
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yeah. Yes, Mitra, please tell me.
I just wanted to know, I mean, it could be a very basic question. Will they mimic or camouflage on any non-biodegradable material?
You mean environment, right? Well, I don't know about this biodegradable. So
every now we have spoken about flowers, plants, barks, and trees and twigs and mimicking them. So I just wanted to know if any other things, materialistic things, like man-made things, will they be able to mimic?
They take the color of soil, actually. Many of those moths, they take the color of soil. You want to know inanimate objects. Inanimate in the environment, maybe looking like rocks, that is possible. But inanimate, which you have put in the environment, it will take some time for the evolution.
Okay, thanks.
One last question as of now, it's from Swati. Do spiders mimic too?
Spiders, I showed the example. It's not mimicry, it is camouflage. Because they are most... spiders, again, another mimicry. I told you, aggressive mimicry. So, Hechamian mimicry or aggressive mimicry, where they take the shape of their prey. For example, Ecophylla smaragdina, the ant which you see on the trees building big nests. So, the similar looking spider stays inside the nest and predates on the spider, on the ants. So, they do take. They mimic.
Thank you, ma'am. I think those are the questions.
Can I ask one question, please?
Yeah, please, Prasad. Please.
Chitra, very nice presentation. Congrats. And then good response also. I just want to ask whether genes have eyes and then they see all the environment and then they mimic camouflage. It appears that the genetics and the phenotype. Because here there is an interplay.
Actually, see, for example, I was hoping that some of the entomologists who joined would further the discussion in industrial melanism because I've read a lot about it. So, gene mutation plays an important role in the change from the speckled form to the carbonaria form. There was a gene mutation. So, actually, what happens is there is a pleiotrophic effect inside. The gene can be responsible for many things. And when mutation occurs in some of the sequences there, then this change occurs. That's what is happening. So it is pressure. It is the pressure of predation that is making it happen. The typical example we have is Biston Biltularia, in which the predation pressure has made it change its color. So over, if you take every insect, it must have been the selection pressure. Like first, which are the image which I showed, the different color forms and how the successful form has propagated itself, has multiplied itself. I think that's what you're...
Yeah, very interesting.
Yeah, it is. Especially the latest papers on it. I was so thrilled to read about it, actually.
Thank you.
That's too good. And especially the discovery of the fossil too, with the trichomes.
Yeah.
It was there from the Cretaceous era in amber. So that is simply amazing. Even I learned a lot of things from this.
Yeah, yes. Sureka?
No, Sureka.
Yes, she's there. Yes, she's unmuted.
Now can you hear?
Yes, Sureka. All questions are
now done. Can you hear? Yeah, there was a question that slipped, I think. Is the caterpillar, which looks like a feather, a pus caterpillar?
Pus caterpillar. That is pussy.
Okay.
Actually, that is a group of caterpillars which are hairy and very soft. They are called like that. They could be any of these, actually. Unless you rear them and find the adult, it is very difficult, actually. We don't have many caterpillar books. First, we don't have moth books. And second, we don't have many caterpillar books.
So, okay, Dr. Prakash Chand Yadav. There is no camouflage in locusts. I am regularly working with locusts since December 2019. I have not seen any camouflage with locusts, Dr. Prakash Chand Yadav.
I think Prasadji will be a better person to answer this.
Dr. YGP, yeah,
locusts, of course, more about behavioral change than camouflage or mimicry. It's about chemical-induced aggressive behavior or grouping behavior. I think it is more to do with behavior than camouflage or mimicry.
Okay. I think, Gautam, that's about all on the
chat. Yeah, all
as
questions
well as
are.
The hands
yes.
raised. We have...
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Chitra. Over to you, Gautam, for...
Yes, guys, we would like to share that a few links where you can, follow Deccan Birders, our updates. You can join our field trips. We generally do 2 field trips in a month and 1 indoor trip. Now, a lot of webinars because of this lockdown. So I'm just sharing you 2 easy links where you can, just go and just join in the Facebook. One is Facebook link where you can join. You can get all our updates. Where are we going? What is happening? Even the webinar invites and all will be sent there. And if you're more serious about joining Deccan Birders, you can directly go to our website, deccanbirders.in. There we have a membership form and all where you can join this thing. So I've just shared these links, guys. Happy to see a lot of, participation. Thank you. Thank you so much. We are really overwhelmed with your response and questions. And Chitraji, you have a lot of patience and knowledge to answer like immense number of questions. Thank you so much. I took a lot of screenshots of all the insects because they look so interesting. I thought, okay, I might not get them back or I won't be remembering the names and all. So it was a really wonderful.
Join me on field trips for seeing insects.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. sure. Definitely.
In fact, I was thinking that all the entomologists can join us on our birding trips because we look up to see birds and you guys will teach us to look down and see insects. So I think it will be a nice camaraderie. We learn from you and we'll be so happy if all of you become members with Deccan Birders so that we learn about birds and then we learn about insects also. That will be a nice combination. Thank you, Chitra, so much. And thank you, all the participants. Thank you, Gautam, for holding the show along with me.
Thank you, Deccan.
Thank you so much, Chitra. It was a fantastic show.
It was awesome. It was an awesome presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Thank you, guys. Good night. Good night, Chitra.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Mr. Gautam, I have a small inquiry. Will there be a posting of this recording somewhere in FB or YouTube?
Yes, I've been sharing the link. I'll share them again. So all of our Deccan Birders webinar link recorded links are uploaded to YouTube. So I've just shared the link. Okay. So you can just follow that playlist. I think maybe in 6 hours or 8 hours it will be updated. So all our webinars will be there in single link.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Smita. Yeah.
Yeah. Can I leave now? Bye.